Chairman, this one is a plan development request that we've been waiting for a while. Such a property, you know, affectionately is 2320 North Patterson. It has an interesting history that has spanned 15 plus years. The property is currently split zone between RP, RP conditional, and CC conditional. A pattern that you see on the map on the screen. All of those incremental zoning changes, the ones that is of recent, have been all trying to further the effort to get this to a plan development proposal. Applicants have spent an awful lot of time and brain faults in coming up with a plan. Heritage Area Institutional Activity Center, this is an association with South River Medical Center and the BSU North Campus, which are both across the street. Aerial imagery, you see most of the property is vacant, has been vacant for many years. A few exceptions to that would be the small office building in the back corner, which has a long history. I've got to give you lots of information about the history there in the packet. Subject property to lay the groundwork. This is a view from North Patterson Street with an existing curb cut into a vacant lawn area. This is looking southwestward. This is that existing building that's on the subject property. This was proposal number two. And I recall the early history 15 years ago. It was a very large 11-story building that was to be built. I have a picture of it for you, though I'll get to it at the end. That was approved right before the Great Recession. That changed everything. Applicants came back and rezoned the property to OP regular to allow them to build this property out in phases. This was done as a spec building back at that time as an effort to get that process started. It was not entirely successful in getting it started. It has been sitting there ever since. Part of its history has actually been occupied. There's a retention pond in the middle of the property. This is from the Development Authority land looking southeastward toward the hospital. This is that lawn area in the south end. This is the South Georgia Jungle South, I call it. This is on the south property line. It is pretty substantial and high is a very large single-family home on the other side. The west side is more interesting. It's a narrow street that fronts a existing single-family neighborhood. This is the view looking southward down the hill along that narrow street toward Roosevelt. Subject property is to your right. These are driveways to existing houses, but it is not the fronts of the houses. It is rear access driveways. These houses front the other street to the west. Subject property, as you can see along the street, is what I also call the South Georgia Jungle. Here, bamboo is the vegetation that seems to be predominant, but also does a very effective job of screening. You may recall from earlier rezoning requests that RP condition for that part of the property along West or North Kittens requires the maintenance of a natural undisturbed buffer. In other words, you keep this in place or enhanced to protect the neighborhood that's on the other side of Kittens. As we come down the hill to Roosevelt, we go back toward Patterson. This is the Valdosta Lowndes County Development Authority office that sits on the corner. This is the cutout in the northwest corner of the subject property. It is not part of the plan development. It is simply adjacent to it. Across the street on the north side of Roosevelt, you have Mackey Park. BSU North Campus to the northeast. South Georgia Medical Center and their large parking deck that's immediately east across the street. And then the conceptual master plan. In your packet, you've got the large 11 by 17 copies. It is two main features. One, they're calling the residential amenity. This is a four-story apartment building, very upscale. The letter of intent in your packet is three pages long. It describes resort-style amenities. In many ways, this reminds me of the proposed McAllister apartment building. For those of you who remember that case from about 7 years ago, which was also a four-story building of a very unique design. That is the anchor and the main focus of this property. You see the red dashed line. That is a parking area that is reserved for the residents. This is 165 dwelling units with 215 bedrooms. If you do the math, you come out to, I think, 1.3 bedrooms per unit. So these are not very large apartments. It is a year homes, upscale amenities, more so than it is family, so it is smaller units. They wanted to separate the parking area between the residential use and the non-residential use. The other buildings, which are labeled A, B, and C with numbers, are one and two-story buildings along Roosevelt and North Patterson, each with their own range of uses, as described there in the letter of intent. Also, the legend that is on the top corner of that master plan gives you much greater detail. They have calculated out the parking using a lot of detail. Based on their mathematics, I think if I read it right, there are two spaces short overall. However, with a commercial center of varying uses, it's actually a different parking standard than what they're using. What they're showing is breaking it down individually. If you use the shopping center parking standard, there are actually a few parking spaces ahead of the game, which personally I think they're going to need, but there is no issue with parking. Many times with planned developments of mixed use, you anticipate parking overlap. In this case, they have done a very good job of making all the numbers work and everything fitting on the property. So in your packet, you have this master plan that describes the two different areas, the detail of the uses, and some very good architecture drawings that are in 3D. This is from southeast looking northwest across Patterson. You see the four-story apartment building, which is very prominent, very residential looking. This is Urban Commercial Corridor Overlay District, which has architectural standards. All of their buildings comply with the overlay district standards. This is the view from the other corner looking southwest. Here you get a little better view of the buildings along Patterson and Roosevelt, and then the large apartment building to the back. Elevation drawings. This is a view of the elevations from the street. So it shows both the smaller buildings along Patterson and Roosevelt in the foreground, the apartment building behind. The existing building, by the way, that's there that you saw the picture of, is being retained. It is shown here as its own little square area in the upper left part of that blue area. They're using that as a converting it to amenity space and leasing office, etc., for the apartments. They're using the building, just simply hiding it from view by their new building. So with all of that, staff is recommending approval of this after finding the plan development consistent with the conference plan, the plan development review criteria, which are in the packet, and recommending approval subject to 9 conditions, which are on the second page of the staff report. If you like, we can go through this in detail. We did not cover them in detail at the work session, but they were in generality. And I can hit the highlights through there.
Cut out some highlights.
All right, the first one. The approval is to describe the mixed-use development that references the apartments, limitations on size, and also references their letter of intent, which describes all the non-resident uses in pretty good detail. Basically, taking them at their word and limiting those types of uses to those sizes that they indicate. And that's also reflected here on the legend at the top of the master plan. 2, final design of the main entrance. That has to do with the entrance which you see above unit C1, which is the red buildings along Patterson. Their main entrance drive lines up more or less with the traffic light that's at the corner of the hospital. A little bit off center, but it lines up. One of the concerns is there's going to be a lot of traffic generated in addition to the traffic that's already here. It's somewhat of an awkward intersection. A traffic study is being required. I'm told by the applicant's engineer they've already completed the study, but it's really to examine that study in detail through the lens of Georgia DOT, and also the city engineer. In other words, there might be some tweaking that goes along in terms of a left turn lane or a right turn lane that might affect this design a little bit. So the purpose of condition number 2 is to hold open that possibility of some changes to the design per DOT and the city engineer. All right, condition number 3, sidewalks to be installed along Roosevelt and Patterson Street frontage. Number 4 is outdoor storage to be prohibited. Outdoor seating in these commercial areas to be described as it's shown here. Number five, landscaping, this is where we mentioned the buffer yards. Per LDR, buffer yard is required on the south property line, there's already a substantial buffer there. The west property line is required by the RP conditional zoning district that is there. So we want to make sure that condition is still in place. And that is not shown specifically on here, but there have been some other drawings leading up to this where they're showing landscaping and buffer yard and even a retaining wall behind this residential building. What's interesting to note is the site is not level, even though this is South Georgia, there's about, I think, 14 feet difference in fall from south to north. The four-story building will actually be recessed into the ground a little bit on the south edge of the property, which means it will mimic a smaller building than what it is. And so with that, to preserve the buffers, you've got to do a small retaining wall there to hold it together. Six is signage. With split zoning of RP and CC, the question goes which way you do the signage. Signage, particularly along the street frontages where the CC zoning is, needs to follow CC rules. So we've noted that there. Only thing we're prohibiting is the temporary signage, which can come with commercial businesses. With this many of them, an institutional area along Patterson, we don't want too much street clutter. And seven, all sight lighting should be directed downward and away from adjacent residential areas. That's already required by code over the four-story building. A little more concerned about that, so that goes in here as a condition. Number eight, all other applicable development standards and requirements shall be followed, including overlay district, which is already demonstrating compliance with. It's just we get to review it against everything else that's not shown. And then number nine is the expiration date of 3 years. And that's to at least get a building built or under construction. One thing I would like to point out, I think on page four, is a list of deviations from the standard development code. As you know, with plan developments, there's always a few deviations, sometimes very minor, sometimes not. This one, most of the deviations are with multifamily development standards, which a lot of times is in the residential multifamily zoning district. This is an RP, but it's part of a mixed-use development. So there's a few things there that they're deviating from. Most of these are very minor in scope. One of them is a requirement that all parking spaces for multifamily be within 200 feet of an entrance. There is about a dozen or two spaces in the southeast corner that are just barely outside the 200-foot radius, so we note those. Building facade length is normally limited to 250 feet. This is a very large building, so it exceeds that in just a few places. And the other one is the parking lots. Normally, we don't want more than 100 parking spaces in one bay. Here, it's part of a much larger intensive site. It's more than 100 parking spaces in one park. So those are some of the examples of the deviations. Those get approved with the plan development. So they're solved, they're patterns. Applicants' representatives are here. We might answer any questions that you might have regarding plan development. And he's down to one, all by himself.
Please. All right. Do we have any questions for staff before I open it up?
Matt, the sidewalk situation, your staff recommendation number three. Help me remember, on Roosevelt, are there any sidewalks now? None.
Not on that side, if I recall right.
On either side?
The park side has one. What we're anticipating is a lot of pedestrian traffic in and out of this site, both going to the hospital and I think also to the park to the north. The site itself needs to connect, which is why we have language in there about pedestrian walkways within the site and connecting it to the outside world.
And so outside you're world needs to be a permanent stop on the frontage on Roosevelt.
Correct, frontage on Roosevelt, so pedestrians can move along the south side of Roosevelt and not be a problem to turn out.
Okay, while I still have the floor of number four, you say outdoor seating areas may be allowed only with separate seating equipment. So,
adjacent to the inward side facing the parking lot A through C, the area shall not block access to this gate. Outdoor seating areas may be allowed only with a separate seating fee. In other words, we want to see how it, the pedestrian traffic will flow through these other buildings. We have some guidelines for outdoor seating in the downtown area, which is large wide sidewalks. And those are our guidelines that we will use.
Yeah, after it's been populated, you'll see how the traffic patterns flow and if that needs to be adjusted at that point.
And the devil's in the details. There's one other main reason I've included that. Restaurants have a higher parking standard than most retail. We're generally using a retail parking standard. The sizes of the cafes are not really large in terms of the restaurant world. But if you add several thousand square feet of outdoor seating, the little cafe becomes a large cafe.
Gotcha.
In other words, we want to see how this is actually working before we get to that point. Outdoor seating and the restaurant parking standard is exempt. We don't count it because it's outdoors, which is, I think, a weakness of the code. But that's one of the reasons I put that in there.
And last but not least, on number five, just tell me briefly, how much additional buffering are you asking for above what is called standard landscape buffer?
Nothing additional in terms of size, but keeping the existing vegetation there, which when you look at those pictures, it works a lot better than a brand new buffer yard. It's going to take 15 years to grow up. So we kind of want the existing to be in place. Of main interest is the landscaping along North Tombs. We know the building is going to be encroaching as close as it can by code. It's pushing it a little bit, but it's there. I have actually been on site with the city arborist where we looked at details of existing trees. What's there is fine as long as it's preserved. But in part of the process, they might want to replace some of the trees, and hence the city arborist comes into play with that.
So everything in number five is standard? You're just
noticing. It is pretty much standard except for existing. Under normal code, North Tombs is not required to have a buffer yard because it's a street frontage. But it was put there as a buffer many years ago with the RP conditional zone. We just want that carried forward with the plan.
All right. Thank you. Appreciate it.
Man, I have a quick question. So I'm just curious. So with South Georgia starting the first ever residency program in January with 15 students the first year, maybe 30 second year, and they keep, you know, as years, I mean, they're here 4 to 6 years. I mean, has there been any conversation at all about a pedestrian bridge from the parking garage across the street?
There has been several conversations. It's not part of the proposal. Not that it can't become part of it, but yes, it is possible. That requires cooperation by both landowners and also Georgia DOT. That's not a simple conversation. But I agree, there's some benefits to it. It's just not featured in the current plan. But yes, I think maybe the applicants will have a waiting list starting soon.
Yeah.
It will take them a little while to get this built.
Oh, they're not going to make the first class. They won't make the first class of residence in January.
Oh, no.
They might not make the second class of residence in January.
All right, let's open it up. Is there anyone here tonight who would like to speak on behalf of this request?
Representative 3998 Incredible Road. I think Matt covered everything. We have already done a traffic study, and we're working that through Georgia DOT, so we'll basically be turning the existing lighted intersection into from a three-lane intersection to a four-lane intersection, which will also have pedestrian crosswalk and lighting associated with that. So one of the other concerns with the pedestrian bridge is that somewhat cost prohibitive to do that. But we will definitely enhance this from the traffic light standpoint, so we have at least a protected lighted pedestrian crossing there. But their main market is to try to market towards the young professional working at SGNC. With the commercial piece there, because there's nothing really service oriented that goes with the hospital anywhere in that area. So the floor is type, you know, cafe type that supports people being able to walk, you know, if you want to go grab lunch, we'll so hopefully, but parking was a challenge for this site, but hopefully with its vicinity to SGMC, a lot of the parking concern may be offset with people walking from SGMC over to the commercial areas.
Think about the car in the park that can walk across the pedestrian bridge, and wouldn't worry about the marketplace on the other side.
There were some early on discussions about possibly some type of joint parking use agreement that, but that didn't get very far.
That's a great idea.
That is a great idea. Did you say that about mine?
It's a great idea, right? All right, any more questions for Clayton?
You don't have any concerns about the parking for the residential?
No, we're, and that's True North is a developer, maybe the, you know, one parking space per bedroom is what they go for, and that's what we're providing for the residential part. We've got one space per bedroom. So that's in there, what they see in all the developments they do, because they don't want to underpark their development, because that just creates issues for them, because they're gonna develop and operate this. They're not just developing it and turning it over. They'll be operating it as well.
What's the timeline, please?
Well, if I can get my plans done, so we're gonna leave. The architecture plans are done, ready to be submitted. As soon as I can get the civil plans, we'll be turning them into that. So
we've been here for 3 hours. You give me one.
True North, they're confident a bit to get started. So.
And I think if I remember right, they're wanting to build a residential building first and get that in place, and then work on the rest. It's the rest of it that has been the variable.
Person in the room, is there anyone here tonight who would like to speak against this request? Gretchen? All right, but that clears out the room. I'll turn it back over to the commissioners. Any discussion? No discussion, I'll call for a motion.
Steve, you got it?
Sure, off the
page. Steve, you got it.
All right. Regarding the case VA 2022-20, I'll make a motion that we recommend approval, including all of the stipulations that are attached.
Okay. We have a motion by Commissioner Miller to approve with all 9 conditions. Do I have a second?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, we have a second by Commissioner Bailey. Any discussion on the motion? All those in favor of the motion to approve, please raise your right hand. All those against, and the motion carries.
Last of the screen, I forget about it completely. I wanted to show you the picture of the building that was talked about 15 years ago.
Oh, that was ahead of its time.
It is the tallest building in Bell Austin. It's a 11-story building, mostly all wizards, with a 5-level parking deck behind it.
Any other business?
Yeah, we don't do sidewalks.